All right. So I think the only thing I changed from the abstract is I actually added a question mark here, posing it more as a question. Well, actually, I think the audience here is pretty familiar, particularly after Andrew's great talk about lunar magnetic anomalies, you know, these regions of enhanced magnetic field, maybe at the surface reaching hundreds of nanoteslas. Sometimes there's visual manifestations of these magnetic features in the form of these spectacular swirls. Again, the origin is still under considerable debate, and we can debate whether that origin is under debate, but I believe it is. One interesting observation is that there seems to be less hydroxylation or less hydrogenation, less hydrogen in these swirl regions. And George Kramer found this and reported back in 2012, and that'll be important as we in this discussion. Now, actually, recently there's been a large number of recent survey investigations modeling these plasma inflow into these magnetic anomaly regions. You know, Andrew's done some great work, and Jan Decca, I think, is going to present his findings at Reiner Gamma right after this talk. There seems to be a common element. Andrew, you hit it in your talk. While there's a magnetic field, it's actually not the magnetic field that directly affects the incoming protons. It's the formation of this electric field that tends to decelerate and reject these incoming solar wind ions. The electric field is formed by the magnetic field, but it's the electric fields that are doing the work. And this is from Mike Zimmerman's 2015 paper on a small magnetic anomaly. Here's the magnetic anomaly with the dipole center in the center here. Electric fields form along, I call them the flanks, but it's really in regions where you get more horizontally oriented magnetic fields. And as it turns out, you get these reflected ions that you talked about, Andrew. One thing that also happens, though, is because of these electric fields, the energy of these incoming ions, incoming protons, gets slowed considerably from 1 keV down, maybe in this example, down to a couple hundred EV, a couple hundred EV. And as a consequence, the ions are less potent when they interact with the surface. So you get reflected ions, an overall reduction in ion flux, and a lower energy, which makes them less potent as they interact with the surface. And this electric field is also in another model by Shahab Fatemi, modeling the Gerasimovich lunar magnetic anomaly. He also saw the development of these large electric fields that tended to peak up around 7 kilometers, but could even be sensed up at 30, should be sensed up at 30 kilometers. It's a model after all, so we haven't gotten there yet. There's both these electric fields form from both ambipolar processes where the plasma itself separates, but also from Hall processes and which really are related to separations in the current or in the drift. So you combine these two and you have this upward-directed electric field. This was measured, Andrew, you talked about this as well, by Sato et al. In 2012, Kaguya at 25 kilometers passed right through one of these. They saw accelerated electrons and decelerated ions, and it kind of matched up what you would expect for a Hall kind of electric field, which would vary as B squared over the densities. They got a nice correlation there. So the modeling and the observations are all coming together here with this electric field in these magnetic anomalies. Now, you might then ask what happens when you decelerate the solar wind. This should affect space weathering. Like without magnetic shielding, the 1 keV protons come in. Each keV proton creates 2 vacancies. Over time, these vacancies sort of create an amorphous layer, which actually are the ones that are studied by the Johnson Space Center group, Lindsay Keller and Sarah Noble and all. And over time, there's an amorphosization. And actually, I had to practice that in the mirror before this talk this morning, to say that. Whereas if there is shielding, okay, you're going to reject the incoming of these same ions are going to be rejected by the electric field. Those few that do get through it's almost like they're on bungee cords. They come down and just kiss the surface. So they're not going to create the same amount of damage. They won't penetrate as deep. Give the appearance of less weathering from a space weather perspective. So what we did is we used TRIM, the transport of ions and material code, to sort of flesh some of this cartoon out a little bit. So one effect is, of course, reduced sputtering. And you get reduced sputtering for 2 reasons. One, of course, is there's just overall less flux into the region. But also, as the energy decreases, the yield drops as well. And this is from trim run for silica, and we're looking at silicon sputtering, and you can see it drops by about a factor of 2 or 3 as you go to lower energies from 100 EV down to 200 EV. A second effect is actually shallower proton implantations. In nominal solar wind, at 1 keV, you might expect to implant at around 22 nanometers or so. But if you've slowed down to, say, 200 EV, you're implanting at maybe 6 nanometers. So you're actually getting almost a factor of 3 or 4 decrease penetration. There's also a peak vacancy layer. You know, as the ions come in, they create vacancies. They don't overlap. Where you implant and where the vacancies lie, the vacancies actually tend to lie a little closer to the surface, and that also reduces in size. The vacancy per ion for solar wind, nominal solar wind, it's about 2 vacancies per proton, but when you decelerate down to, say, 200 EV, it's actually down by a factor of 10 to like 0.2 vacancies per ion. So that, you know, that means that there's a lot less overall damage. So we can actually relate this to a solar wind weathering rate. You can write down a sort of a handy dandy, very simple vacancy growth rate, vacancy rate equation, which represents the number of vacancies through this non-thermal solar wind generated process, where alpha is the trim related vacancy per ion, F is the solar wind flux in your layer, and then that has to be matched with vacancy losses, and losses through annealing and vacancy diffusion and refilling with displaced atoms. Beta here is the proton implantation probability. Remember, 50% might be reflected, some number reflected, some portion might be immediately backscattered as neutrals, and then some smaller fraction actually represents those that actually get implanted. And if you scale this both in and outside of the magnetic anomaly region, you know, alpha outside to alpha inside is about a factor of 10, and the branching ratios, given the amount of backscattered protons themselves, might be on a factor of 2 or 10, which means you might expect the solar wind weathering rate to decrease by a factor of 20 to 100. And actually, that may be enough to maybe be slow or comparable to micrometeoroid turnover. So you might think of this as like a rotisserie chicken that you've turned too early. And so the side doesn't get completely cooked. You might have the rotisserie chicken model of regolith. Maybe I should stop on that one. That's not working out too well. Anyway, the point is you maybe are interrupting the amorphosization process so that you don't get so that what little damage you're getting is getting overturned before you can. So you're seeing thinner, less developed grain rims. Just an idea. You know, another thing we work on is hydrogen diffusion. Once you implant the proton, it escapes the surface as hydrogen. In non-magnetic regions, these hydrogens have to pass through the damaged layer to get out, really a damaged layer of its own creation. So there's almost like a self-fortifying, you know, the hydrogens stay retained because of the damage that they create. And some evidence for this is in Finkenau, who looked at the diffusion of hydrogen back out of the surface, and for irradiated silica, found that the diffusion rates are down by nearly a factor of 10 to the 5. And what they call the hindered H diffusion, because the irradiation affects the oxygen chemistry. But in magnetic anomalies, maybe they buzz out a little faster, first because they're shallow, so they don't have as far to go, but then there's maybe less damage in the layer. And this is where we actually published a hydrogen Monte Carlo diffusion code, where we actually looked at nominal implantations and implantations in magnetic anomalies, and ran in both cases similar diffusion parameters for 10 to the 5 seconds. And you get a lot less material hanging around in magnetic anomaly regions, primarily because you're really up close to the surface and the stuff can easily escape out, as opposed to the deeper implantations for the 1 keV solar wind. We also start out with a reduced flux as well. Well, this may relate back to George Kramer's work back in 2011, where in Reiner gamma, for example, there was less OH. In this case, what you're looking at here is the 2.8 micron feature, and where dark represents less hydroxyl And whiter means more hydroxyl. And you can see that it's darkened in here, meaning that there's less retained hydrogen. So to conclude, the deceleration of solar wind and I call them the flanks, it's really, that's probably not the right word. It's really in locations where there's a horizontal, more horizontal-oriented magnetic field, might have a reduced damaging rate in the crystal. There are five effects that, as a consequence of this deceleration: reduced sputtering, reduced vacancy depth, reduced vacancy production, the weathering rate, slower weathering rate, and quicker hydrogen diffusion. And if we continue this logic, you might ask the question, should we expect the amorphous solar rain grims, the rims at the very top that are formed from solar wind, not from those from impact condensate, but from those from solar winds, might they be a little thinner and maybe not as developed as you would have as compared to the Apollo samples? After all, we're only getting these protons in at around 10 nanometers, less than 10 nanometers. And moonrise may give us an opportunity to do this because, in fact, your image of this is a little better than my own, but the South Pole Aiken Basin has a lot of magnetic anomalies. Bose Crater, which is one of their sites, is right here over this kind of a weaker magnetic anomaly. And maybe there could be evidence for these different kinds of rims in that data set when they return a sample, if they can get into one of these magnetic anomaly regions. So, okay, I think that's it. Sorry, there's some bold speculation here, I think that's BS, right?
Bold speculation,
right.
That's what it stands for.
That's right.
All right, any questions for Bill?
Really interesting work. How sure are we that the amorphosization layer affects the spectral properties of space weathering? You know, the optical changes and band depth and reddening.
Yeah, that's a good question. And that depends on the kind of layer. In fact, I was just talking to Sarah about this yesterday. The nanophase iron tends to be more in, and Sarah, hopefully I'm saying this right, tends to be more in the vapor deposits from impacts. So the amorphous rims that are from solar wind are cleaner in terms of nanophase ion. So they may not affect the spectral properties, at least in the IR. Now in the UV, that's another story, because there are these weird things that can happen with defect sites where you can actually get an electron in there and it can affect absorption features down in the UV. They're called e-centers. And I actually had a couple slides on that, but I wasn't sure I was going to get through the talk on that. But anyway, so there could be an effect, but not necessarily in the IR, maybe more in the UV.
Additional questions for Bill? I think we're good on time. So I
give you the cue.
Okay.